Welcome to Thundercast, Thunder Tech's podcast where we give you our take on what's new in marketing, what's cool, what's lame, and why you should care.
Hey there, and welcome back to Thundercast, Thunder Tech's regular podcast. As always, I'm your host, Craig Israel, joined with my regular co-host, Eric Krylo.
Howdy, Craig.
Howdy, Eric. So today we have another podcast in our series of podcasts that we're putting out to support our 2018 Trends publication. This is the book we put out every year that collects some of the trends and marketing things of interest that we've been tracking and writing about. It's available right now. As you listen to this podcast, you can go to thundertech.com/trends2018. That's trends 2018, and download your free copy right this minute. So today's podcast is going to cover one of the topics that are in the Trends book, influencer marketing, and help walk us through that. We have a very special guest in the studio, Shantae Rollins.
Woo!
Howdy.
So Shantae is back and excited about being on the podcast
so
again.
So excited.
So you're going to walk us through influencer marketing, what it means, why it's a trend, and why everybody should go out and start influencing? I don't know.
Sure.
Okay, so let's start with the basics. For our listening public, explain what influencer marketing means in a nutshell.
Right, so influencer marketing kind of evolved from word of mouth, and there's always been somebody who's like the face of a brand or the face of a product who's kind of selling it or trying to connect with customers. So,
like Colonel Sanders.
Like Colonel Sanders, mm-hmm. or not. And influencer marketing, you know, it's those people who specifically live in like that digital space and have a specific niche and they have a devoted following. And those people are engaged and those people could be your customers. And so it's connecting with those influencers to connect with your customers.
So this is not, I mean, years ago we had celebrity endorsements, right? We still have celebrity endorsements today. But this isn't Fred Flintstone smoking Winston on the show. This is beyond that.
Huh?
Yeah, for reals.
They smoked cigarettes on the Flintstones.
No, the Flintstones used to have commercial breaks where Fred and Barney would be like, "Hey, Barney, I could still sure use a Winston right now, and Winston smokes good like a cigarette should."
Oh, and they just puff it on those squares like it's nobody's.
That's right. And yeah, so okay. Hold, please, Shantae.
Right.
So a little history. Yeah, so you can look it up. It's the old Flintstone cartoons, like the black and white cartoons. And the best part is that they wouldn't cut to something that was like manifestly different. So people watching would be like, oh, this is a commercial. This isn't part of the regular show. Just the action would continue. So like the scene, whatever happened, then like Fred and Barney would walk out behind the garage and light up a Winston. Smoke for a while, talk about how great it is, and then
Brontosaurus walked by with a cigar in his mouth.
Yeah, see, that's the part that disappoints me, is that it wasn't like hand-rolled by a bird or, or you know, somehow carried in by dinosaurs. It didn't. It was just like a paper pack of Winstons, and they would check
right.
one out and light it up.
Well, then you got Bam Bam snorting limestone in the quarry, right?
I think that came later.
So, and without, I guess, staying on this too long, do you think that they smoked Winstons back then in the prehistoric times because emphysema didn't exist back then?
Oh, sure. It hadn't been invented yet, so you could smoke without any consequences at all.
Nice. Caveman. Let's go back.
Okay, back to influencer marketing.
Right.
So, in reading the article that you wrote, Shantae, for the Trends publication, a stat that really jumped out at me was that you write that most customers, I mean, you don't write this, right? This is from a Forrester research study, that most customers will have completed 79 to 90% of their personal journey by the time they engage the brand.
Right.
So this is way different than how you think of traditional marketing, where you raise your awareness through a TV commercial or radio or whatever, then you engage with the brand either mm-hmm. through collateral or a website. So what you're saying is that before the brand even becomes aware of a potential customer, they're almost done with all their research.
They're almost done. They are doing their due diligence, they're looking at reviews, they're checking out their favorite blogger who might be talking about a specific product, or they see it on Instagram and they're engaging with an influencer who's sharing about like a boot that they want to buy because it's boot in sweater season, whatever. Before they ever get to the point where they're ready to make that purchase, they've already done all of their homework. They don't need to hear from the brand. They're hearing from other customers. They're hearing from those influencers who are talking about it and having honest conversations and not just pushing a specific agenda like sell, sell, sell. So when they come to you, they're already ready. And influencer marketing is kind of a way to for brands to have a little bit more control over that journey. Maybe not control, but kind of sneak in the back door and help control sort of what that conversation is and what that message kind of is and reach those customers before they ever come to the brand.
So I got to imagine that because everything you're saying makes sense to me, but I got to imagine that the key to this is that those influencers don't come across as salesmen, right? That it feels like a genuine, authentic, like, reaction to the product or service.
Right. It's not they're not hawking something just to hawk it. Like, they have you know, it fits in with their personal brand that they're sharing online. So say they're a lifestyle influencer and they're talking about, you know, green smoothies. Like, they're not just talking about green smoothies because everyone's talking about green smoothies. You know, it's part of their lifestyle, their healthy lifestyle that they choose to engage in. And so their followers are more likely to respect them and trust them because they have this consistent brand and they're not talking about products that just don't align with them.
Right. So if that health food guru influencer one day starts talking about how they enjoy a nice Winston in the garage, that's not going to come across as genuine.
Not at all.
So then how is that connection made between ultimately the brand and the consumer then if according to you, the brand's not visible at all throughout this early portion of the process? Mm-hmm. How does that light finally turn on, or how is that connection finally made?
Brands have to do their research if they want to work with influencers. It's first knowing, I think, who your audience is. You know, it's like, where are they? What are they listening to? Who are they talking to? Where do they get this information to make these decisions before they ever come to my site to make a purchase? And then seeking out those people who influence your audience and connecting with them on an authentic level, not just going to them and say, hey, I have this product that I think would be a really good fit and we have a promotion coming up, so we'd really like for you to talk about it on Twitter. That there's not anything really authentic about that either. So it's doing your homework and taking your time to build those relationships with people, you know, sharing some of their content. It's kind of it's you have to give something to get something, and that's a long-term approach, I think, to influencer marketing. So smart brands are looking at the influencers who are influencing their audience and then connecting with them in a way that benefits the brand but also benefits that influencer too.
Yeah, so that was more of the old model when influencer marketing really started to come to the fore, is where you would pay Kim Kardashian $10,000 to mention your designer handbag on her Twitter feed, right? But in the article, you outline that those, like, one hit isn't the way to go anymore. That influencers, it's an always on model now, where you have these long tail relationships, not just you mention the product once and then never mention again.
Right. I mean, you might get a little bit of a lift, right, from like a quick hit influencer campaign, but it's less this campaign, like you said, this campaign-driven approach and more of the always-on approach, because that temporary buzz does fizzle out. And so it's finding ways to fold an influencer into all of your marketing efforts throughout, you know, an entire year, not just the holiday season when you really want to push something, but having that ever-present relationship with them to be able to share content that matters and is going to help your customers make decisions wherever they are in their journey.
So how in execution, how does this work? This is something I can't quite get my head around, because I'll give you an example. So like on YouTube, I watch a lot of woodworking videos because I'm an amateur woodworker. Just started getting into it.
I did not know that, Craig.
Well, it's true. I expect a little something special this Christmas.
Okay.
Birdhouses all around.
That's right. Ashtrays and birdhouses. So
shelves. I built a shelf in shop class.
I bought quick side note. I was so bad at shop. I wanted to be good, but in shop class, I was so bad. I remember building magazine holder
okay.
for my parents, and it had these like dowel rods in the front of it, and like not a one of them like aligned. It looked like, you know, like a spastic 4-year old
right.
had glued a bunch of pieces of wood together.
So whose idea was that? Why didn't you make like a toy box or something, you know, something easy?
I want to say that we were given like, here's 3 things you can build, right? Not whatever you want.
Right.
And you know, looking back at it, I'm amazed that the shop teacher just kind of sat in his office while these teenagers ran wild in the shop class full of you know, jigsaws and table
right.
saws
right.
and things that you could literally cut your fingers off.
Now, that was America being great again. You know, you leave the children to their own, you know, to their own vices and just see what happens.
That's
you know,
right.
You'll learn the first time you cut yourself on a bandsaw.
That's
you'll
right.
learn.
This generation of snowflakes could do well with losing a digit or two to
exactly.
toughen them up.
Exactly.
Okay, so I'm watching these woodworking videos, and occasionally I have a YouTube guy who will be like, this episode's brought to you by Rockler. I'm like, okay, I get it, that there's money has changed hands, you're mm-hmm. mentioning his name or the company's name, and then you're getting something. I'm okay with that. But like during the video, the woodworker will say something like, okay, now to accomplish this, I'm going to use my DeWalt compact router with optional plunge base. And it's just, it's so obvious.
Mm-hmm.
Like, okay, you've been instructed to mention this particular power tool that it immediately like takes me out of the experience and makes me a little cynical. So how does an influencer like constantly reinforce the brand without coming across as ham-handed and false?
Subtly. I don't think that you have to specifically say, if you've already said that something is sponsored by a brand, you don't have to necessarily, and I guess this is again up to the brand and the influencer and however they make their deal, but just having that product placement in your video, having links in the description of that YouTube video that link directly to a product page, or there's a special discount code that's offered for something. You know, I follow a lot of makeup YouTubers. And so maybe there's a product that I want to try and there is a special, you know, discount code that's assigned to that influencer that I can use and I can get 20% off something. So maybe I'll use that code if I want to try something. It looks great on this influencer. I trust that, you know, I follow them, so I trust that whatever they're saying is true. But I also know I'm going to get a discount on it, so why not? So I think that there's a way to sort of fold it in, and you know that it's sponsored, and you know that the brand has a hand in this without it being, and you should be using this whatever. You know, it's more about giving the influencer, I think, some freedom to have an authentic conversation about your product or your service without it being too forceful and too salesy.
Yeah. So that sounds like the key is that the brand has to be flexible enough to understand that it's going to be better for you if I don't name drop 5 times through
right.
the video or through the, you know, to my Twitter feed or whatever, that it has to be more organic and genuine experience, and then you'll benefit. And I imagine that's hard for a lot of brands to just say, okay, I'll trust you that even though you're not saying like the name or we're not zooming in on the logo, this mm-hmm. is still going to have some effect.
Well, I imagine that those types of videos will evolve. So, you know, once that influencer first starts out, they probably have a banner behind them that says DeWalt. They mention it at the beginning. They got DeWalt wristbands. And then as things go on and they start to get more feedback, I bet that stuff starts to ramp down. Because at the end of the day, I think it's really about the final product, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you say at the beginning, you know, hey, we're using DeWalt power tools for this, and then you build a kick-ass magazine stand, not to rehash old memories here, Craig, for you, but I'm assuming
painful.
Redemption's coming for you soon.
Fingers crossed.
Assuming once they see that final product, it kind of resonates and say, oh, I'll buy DeWalt and I too can build a fancy magazine rack.
So we've been talking a little bit about like B2C, like consumer-facing influencers, but in the article, Shantae, you say that B2B is coming into its own too in terms of influencer marketing.
Yes. B2B organizations have been a little bit slower to adopt it because it's like, how does that work? It just seems like such a natural fit for a B2C company to leverage influencers to sell.
This person I know and trust uses this product, so I want to use this product, right?
Right. But at the end of the day, buyers are people too, right? their buyers, and they might be buying thousands, you know, of dollars worth of a product, but they're still people, and they are still influenced as well. They want to connect with people who are influential in their industry. They're thought leaders. They can be trusted before they make this decision, because a lot of times I feel like they have to make the case to someone else internally. And so the more information that you have, whether that's, you know, that's where that content comes in, that you can kind of work with your influencers to co-create content and amplify that content on their channels if they're a trusted source that a buyer might go to before making a really big expensive purchase like that.
Yeah, that made a lot of sense to me when I read that part of your article, that no matter how much you're buying, you're still an individual first. So if I'm responsible for buying a fleet of trucks for my company, if I feel, if there's an influencer who's telling me that you know, Chevy is great, and then I'm looking at a fleet and it's Chevy versus Ford, and, you know, prices is comparable, yeah, I might go with the brand that the influencer favors, because right. I personally have some sort of affinity to the brand and the influencer.
Right, exactly.
Okay, so influencing and influencing the purchases is all well and good, but smart brands are tracking the results too, right?
Right. It used to just be enough to say we got a bunch of likes, and that's not real measurement. You know, you have to build measurement, I think, when you're setting your goals with an influencer marketing campaign. So, if you want to drive traffic, then you need to have a trackable link that your influencer can share. If you want to be able to track downloads, same concept. You just have to be thinking about what those KPIs are and then connecting with your influencer in a way that they're going to be able to fold that in and drive those conversions for you, you know, drive those leads. And that could even be, you know, a trackable code. There can be a promo code that's special just for that influencer and their following. So it's just being smart about what do you want to accomplish by even investing in an influencer marketing campaign, and then building in the tools that are going to help you measure if it's successful or not. Also, a lot of the platforms now are offering some flexibility specifically for, you know, we look at middle market companies who may not have a bunch of money to invest in an influencer marketing campaign. They need to be mindful of those resources. And so there's a lot of audience level data and analytics that help provide those marketers with that real-time information so they can make tweaks and adjustments to their campaigns, working with their influencers on the fly to make the biggest impact.
All right. Thank you, Shantae, for coming in and telling us the latest and greatest about influencer marketing.
It's good to have you back in the room, Shantae.
Thanks for having me.
This has been part of a series of podcasts with articles found in our 2018 Trends publication. To download your copy of Trends, visit thundertech.com/trends2018 for your free copy today. If you like this podcast, you can subscribe to Thundercast on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever fine podcasts are sold. If you do subscribe on iTunes, take a second to leave us a review. We would appreciate it. If you're dying to hear more, our full library of 60-plus past episodes can be found on our website at thundertech.com/podcast. And if you have a topic you'd like us to discuss on a future Thundercast, send us a tweet at Thundertech. Thundercast is a production of Thundertech, an integrated agency for the connected world, headquartered in Cleveland, Ohio, and serving clients in Detroit, Chicago, New York, around the nation, and internationally. Your hosts are Craig Israel and Eric Krylo. This episode was recorded, edited, and produced by Matt Stevens. Thundertech's production coordinator and special guest today is Shantae Rollins. So, Eric, who influences your purchasing decisions?
This is an easy one, and it's Thundertech all the way. They're the folks that put the dollars in my bank account, and that is what influences what I purchase.
Right on. Thanks for listening. That's Thundercast for this week.